topic, I want to believe that by the end of the day, you'll probably have an idea of how you can discover your spiritual gift and your calling. But I don't want us to be proud. I don't want us to be conceited that, guys, I'm the new apostle. First years, second years, third years, and fourth years. I don't want you to start feeling, brethren, I need to be given a chance to prophesy in the church today. Praise the Lord. What is us in fear? Spiritual gifts. Paul starts by telling the Corinthians, which is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, is a scripture that we'll go through. We'll go through the whole of it, but it's portions. He starts by telling them that he does not want them to be ignorant of the spiritual gifts. Now, I need to give us a distinction that the fivefold ministry, we say on Friday, those are administrative roles in the church. But this was a theory. And I will help us understand how the spiritual gifts come together with the administrative roles in the church. The spiritual gifts are different from the ministry roles because the spiritual gifts are given to all believers. But this was a theory. Are we together? I hope you have found that distinction. I would also want to tell you that spiritual gifts are also different from talents. Can you tell your neighbor one or two talents that you know? Praise the Lord. Or you can tell them your talent. Or you have not yet discovered one. All right. A talent is a natural, inborn ability to do a certain task. That is the first thing. It's a natural, inborn. That means that even before you are born again, you actually had it. But this was a fear. You had the talent. Others have learned or have grown a talent. For example, I was telling guys on Friday that in high school I was trying to learn how to play a keyboard. I was not born knowing how to play the keyboard. Praise the Lord. But this was a fear. The guys over there, they should confirm whether I'm talking the truth. Daniel, are you born knowing how to play the keyboard? You learn, see you? But this was a theory. But there are people who are able to learn easily coordination of such things, coordination of their voices. Last Friday I tried to sing. I will never do that again. And then there's a thank you for helping me out. You know? There are things that are called keys in singing. And I've never known, I know see all that, but Kulinganisha. But guess what? If you come to the choir ministry, when you go to do a recording, you'll be taught on vocals. Praise the Lord. Choir, I might join you guys, you know? That's not fun. Concerning the spiritual gifts, I don't want you to be ignorant. I need you to know about these things. That's what Paul is saying. You know that you are Gentiles carried away to these damn idols, however you are led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God called Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. And Paul is saying, remember we say that these are given so that we do ministry. They are divine enablement for us to be able to perform the task of ministry and edify the church. So Paul says that no one can preach the gospel but by the help of the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. No one can preach the gospel apart from the help of the Holy Spirit. By the way, brethren who try to preach the gospel outside the confines of the scriptures and the Holy Spirit, they end up preaching heresies. Are we together? But this was a fear. And some of the practices that we see in the church today by some of the so-called ministers, just by looking at what they are preaching, Jesus says that a good tree cannot produce bad fruit. And a bad tree cannot produce good fruit. And he says, you will know them by their fruits. But this was a fear. So some of the theatrics that we see on the pulpit in some of the churches today, you can clearly see that that person is not being used by the Holy Spirit. Because the thing they are doing, the preaching and the ministry that they are preaching, is not according to the teaching of Jesus Christ. Number two, Paul says, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. By the way, I'm reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. Please note here, Paul talks about two different things. Number one, difference in spiritual gifts. And number two, difference in ministries. And the ministries are from the Lord Jesus. Ephesians chapter 4 verses 11, the Bible says, it is the Lord Jesus who gave some to be. In 1 Corinthians, where we are reading, we will see down there that it is the Holy Spirit who gives the spiritual gifts. But this was the theory. Are we together? Paul is trying to say that there is a difference between the spiritual gifts and the ministries. The ministries are the ones that we have read in Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11, whereas the gifts are what we'll continue reading here. Number three, but manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one. I need to stress that point. Praise the Lord. But the manifestation of the Holy Spirit is given to each one. Well, Ephesians 4 says that to some are given the ministries, the gifts of the Spirit of God are given to each one of you. And he continues to say, for the profit of all. So, the spiritual gift is a manifestation of the Holy Spirit in you for the benefit of all believers in the body of Christ. Then he says, for to one is given the spirit of wisdom, so he leads them down. Then, for to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, and to another different kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. So what you're saying here is, Paul defines the gift of the Holy Spirit, lists them down as word of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, healing, working of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, and speaking in tongues, and the interpretation of tongues. He continues to say, but one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. But this was the theory. Are we together? Alright? Paul is actually stressing a point here. Number one, that the Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit are given to every individual, and yet they are given according to the will of the Holy Spirit. Now, why is Paul stressing this? Because some of us, even today in our church, we see apostleship, working of miracles is more prestigious than every other thing. The gift of service that he talks in Romans chapter 12, look at that. Some people start feeling, mimi, I'm a graduate, from a national. Sasa mimi ni evangelist. Praise the Lord. We've had that, Sanatoka, hapa chini, tianapanda juu, Mungu amenunua kiwango kingine. And then another time, especially for people who become pastors, and the congregation becomes large like this one, they start saying now, you see, I have spiritual sons here. But this was the Sasa mimi, I'm an apostle of the Lord. What I need you to note here is that these gifts, they are not given just because we want. They are given because of the desire or the will of God. But Yesu asifiwe. So some of the people who call themselves apostles, and I will say that here with confidence, Johnson. Some of the brethren who call themselves apostles, and graduating from evangelist to pastor, from pastor to bishop, some of them, they are not really called either. I personally believe that, and I like the example of guys like Akina Bonke and all these important mighty evangelists who have transversed this world preaching the gospel, yet not even one time, when they saw millions of people in a big stadium, they started now saying, guys, I've graduated. But this was effective. But this was effective. In ministry, it's not a graduation, it's a calling. According to the will of the Holy Spirit. Let's continue. Let's talk about unity and diversity in one body. Let's continue. The Bible says that for as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink in one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, is not one member, but many. And Paul is saying that we all now, all of us together, joined together, form the body of Christ. We are so diverse in our callings, in our personalities that God has given you and that God created you with. But in all these, we become one body of Christ. Praise the Lord. But this was it. In other words, without you, the body is less. One organ. Let me call it that. Praise the Lord. You are important. You are that important in the body of Christ. The gifting that God has given you, no matter how people view it, whether it is serving or the gift of mercy, it is so important in the body of Christ. And Paul goes ahead and says, about submission now, he says, if the foot should say, because I am not hand, I am not of the body. You know, the foot wants to be the hand, and so it says, because I'm not the hand, I'm not part of the body. And he's trying to give us this imagery so that we have a clarity of what it means that you cannot be separated from the body of Christ. But this was his favorite. He continues to say, if the ear should say, because I'm not I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? Well, if the ear would say, you mean it's your matter, meaning I don't belong to this body, can that ever be a truth? Can that ever be a truth? No. Unless it cut itself down. Continues to say, if the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he pleased. But this was superior. The Bible says, Paul says, that it is God who created you, and he put the ear where it is as it pleased him. He put the nose where it is as it pleased him. There's a brother here who used to be a prayer coordinator. Whenever he would start and he would keep on telling people about this topic, he would say that sasa kama wewe, akibanzi wewe, wendi ya masikio in the body of Christ. Another person he tells him, wewe purity, you are the legs, you know? Kamau, wewe diye mikono. But this was the theory. This guy would keep on saying that. And what he's trying to say is, in connection with this, is that God put you with your gifting and the ministry calling where God has placed you as it pleased him. Praise the Lord. Are we together? It is the pleasure of God to make you a miracle. It is the pleasure of God to give you the gift of serving. And the best way that you can please God in your life here as a Christian is to obey that calling. Don't forget what I said when I started, that it's not about the titles, it's about obedience to God and what pleases the Lord. Let's continue. But now, indeed, there are many members, yet one body. And if the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body who seem to be weaker are necessary. Praise the Lord. Those members of the body that seem to be weaker are actually most necessary. That's what happens. Sometimes in our churches, we look down on particular members of the church because of the ministry they do. Sometimes you hear, you know, what mission hapa, wanasema mimi nipange hall. I'm not an usher. Praise the Lord. I'm have a higher calling. If you have not said that, may the Lord forgive you. Praise the Lord. Repent, all right? The weakest of them, listen to what Paul continues to say. The bodies which seem to be weaker. And I need to note that word, but my notes have actually put it in bold. They seem, in other words, they are not really. This is to prevent corona. Thank you. Oh, Barindi, okay. Microphone, nice Barindi. All right. Thank you for that icebreaker. People are very serious. So Paul says that the parts that seem, in other words, they seem, they appear to be. That means they are not weak, they only appear to be. Praise the Lord. Paul was an apostle. At one point he tells these guys, that guys, of sinners, I was the chief of them. It has not brought that guys, I'm an apostle. He actually comes in humility, recognizing where Jesus took him from, persecuting the church, and given him so much grace to even be called an apostle. He says, I am the least of the apostles. Praise the Lord. The greatest of them, and I'll say greatest in quotes, because Paul never considered himself great. But today, by the way, you know when Paul was writing the letters, he did not know that they would end up being part of your Bible. I hope you know that. Praise the Lord. So today, we feel Paul, the great apostle. But according to him, he was the least among them. According to other believers like Peter says that, guys, even the things that this guy is writing, I don't understand. Praise the Lord. Yet Paul himself considered himself to be the least of the apostles. In Acts chapter 10, the story of Cornelius, and Peter goes to preach the gospel after he had seen the vision and all that. Go and read. But Cornelius comes and bows before him. And Peter tells him, Ebusi mama mbio sana, you know, praise the Lord. I am but just a man like you. Can you see the level of humility? I know some of us here, now that we are the assistant pastors in our home, when our pastor is invited to preach, like in Kisi University, we ought to sit here, you know, man of God, that to kubebe Biblia, tap in the anointing. Praise the Lord. We scare wap, you tell me, we say, kapa bila hapo na mbisa. You know? It's my Timothy. Praise the Lord. Continually, the ministers today, we are continuing to be proud and struggling with humility in our calling. You know, Jama is here. No, Abba Kisi, so I'll not say who it is. But he went to a particular high school to preach. He was invited. He had that hard weather. He was invited to preach. So when he was going, first he asked them, guys, in another one, praise the Lord. He told them, please look for another hotel. That is below my standard. Guys, it saddens my heart this morning that the kind of culture that we have found in the church is a culture of pride in the pulpit. Because God has used you to heal someone, now we feel that person owes me. Praise the Lord. Look, read the Bible. Read the book of Acts. See the kind of ministry that these guys were doing. So much humility, yet so much use by God. By the way, let me tell you something. The issue of working of miracles, that is a very normal thing in the Bible. There were other guys that were actually gouged Yani amefunguka macho. Peter wewe sasa utakuwa apostle. Instead, these guys were actually put in prison for such things. Praise the Lord. These guys suffered for such things. Sasa leo uko na watumishi hapa, you know? They are actually faking miracles. Can you imagine the level we have took down? The man ko hapo analipa wasee amekaa pale nyuma. And then he says, I can see you. Sana hapo sijui uko na mdomo imekaaje. The Lord is speaking to you. And to make it worse, one of them that I saw being, you know, exposed, this particular woman was actually a prostitute. And to make it worse, he was sleeping with her. But this was here. Can you remember the story of Eli and his sons? When the women were coming to offer sacrifices and to bring their sacrifices at the temple, these guys were doing what is now called temple prostitution. And God rejected them. But this was evil. And because of that, Eli, the priesthood that God had given to Eli, was taken from him and given to Samuel. Guys, the issue of ministry is not a joke. Are we together? Just because God is using you to preach his word does not mean that you actually lord over people. It's not a means of gaining. Today guys are selling miracles. You know? Praise the Lord. Guys are selling miracles. You makuta kutoka wapi? Ki sambo kwa nayo kwa rubena kwake and pray. You're being sold anointing oil from Israel, the holy water. The Bible says the only thing that can sort your life is Jesus Christ. There is nothing, no special oil. In fact, the only place that is mentioned about anointing oil is the book of James, where the Bible says, is anyone among you sick? Let him call the elders to come and anoint him with oil. That is the only place. Israel, anoint yourself. We talk about. But this was a fail. Have you seen it in the Bible? Praise the Lord. Please allow me to go ahead in the interest of time. So he continues to say that, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, of this we bestow great honor. I love this. Praise the Lord. Let me read again. And those members of the body that seem to be less honorable, we do what? We bestow what?
Honor.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Actually, he says greater honor. I don't want to name ushers, but I know that they are the ones that people feel, eh? Praise the Lord. Like they are the lowest. I already said they seem, they are not. But now, those that we feel like they are the lowest, they are the ones that we should give greater honor. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
By the way, at this point, let me say this. This title of mission, squeezing, we are actually misusing. We are actually misusing. Mtumishi is now a title, probably higher than an apostle, you know. But let's not feel it. Ukiitwa mtumishi, you feel, yes, these guys are recognizing. Whereas, you know, you guys know Kiswahili, I mean, mulipita Kiswahili kwa university. Mtumishi na manisha nini? It's not a servant. Praise the Lord. And Jesus says that the greatest among you must serve others. And he led by example. Let me give you an idea. Why Peter was refusing to be, his feet be washed by Jesus. Because the work of washing people's feet was the lowest of the lowest of servants. Israel was in like a desert-like place. And these guys, you know those sandals that Jesus was called over here? Praise the Lord. The ones that I see memes saying ladies are now wearing. Hallelujah, ladies. Those ones. Now imagine, umetapa dust, you know, the whole day ministry, preaching and healing people, and then umekuja kwa nyumba, and Jesus is actually stooping down to wash your feet. So that, and Jesus told Peter, Peter, if I cannot wash your feet, you cannot be my disciple. Praise the Lord. Because Jesus is trying to tell us that the servants, the people who he is calling in ministry, we are supposed to be the ones washing people's feet. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Unfortunately, today is the opposite, you know. Thank God to this Christian Union, we don't have this, but some other places, when a man of God is preaching and he's sweating, there's a guy there, you know, wiping his sweat. You know? With his own handkerchief. And it must be a new one. But this was a feeling. Let's please continue. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no division in the body. Umesikia kwa nini? Kwa nini usifiwe? Why has God given greater honor to the part of the body that are less honorable? The ones that are seemingly less honorable, they are treated less honorable, and they go on out there living a poor life, you know? Well, the man of God here, we are building and buying them late robbers, death, and the like. They are living posh. Well, they are guys who go serving God silently, feeling less honorable, and they are suffering. A certain church somewhere, the pastor, this particular pastor, he was being ordained, and he was having a 500K ceremony. And then I learned later that his assistant pastor, his children have actually been chased away from school. This guy, assistant pastor, is actually starving at home. It's very sudden. Praise the Lord. Let me read very fast. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 1 to 5. Follow the way of love and eagerly desire gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. For anyone who speaks in a tongue does not speak to people but to God. Indeed, no one understands them. They utter mysteries of the, by the Spirit. But the one who prophesies speaks to the people for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. Anyone who speaks in a tongue edifies themselves, but the one who prophesies edifies the church. I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets those tongues, so that the church may be edified. But this was still. Time did not allow me to indulge much in this. But I want to say this. Paul says that of the gift of the Holy Spirit, of course, these guys, the Corinthians, were struggling with speaking in tongues in front of people, and they struggle even today, hallelujah. But this was still. But he says, if you speak in tongues, you are speaking to God, unless someone interprets those tongues. So when you are here and you are preaching, if I start here speaking in tongues, all of you will start wondering, Tumishi, mesema nini? Praise the Lord. Are we together? He actually says in another place, I think the same chapter down there, he says that I speak in tongues more than all of you. But he's trying to challenge them that desire to speak in tongues because it is the heart language of God, but when you are before people, desire the gift that will edify the church directly. And this is the gift of prophecy. On Friday we say that prophecy is actually not for telling only, but the big picture of prophecy is actually proclaiming God's message to people so that they either turn to him or are encouraged. Very fast. How do you discover your calling? 5 points. I'll just mention them in the interest of time. Number one is through life experience. That God uses to burden our hearts for a purpose. For example, in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 1 and chapter 2, Nehemiah received the news of the state of Jerusalem. And the Bible says that he mourned for actually about 2 months. He was in deep mourning for the state of Jerusalem. And God gave Nehemiah the gift of leadership the gift of bringing people together and all that to go and do that work. God gave him the burden to go and rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. Number two, prophetic word. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 14. Paul tells Timothy to fire up the gift of the Spirit that he received through prophetically through the laying hands on by the elders in the church. So the second thing is prophetically edify God's people. Number three, God gives people a passion for a particular task. Throughout your life, the experiences that you have, but also to think about the life of Moses. Moses stayed in Egypt, in the palace for 40 years. And then, after he killed the Egyptian, you know, God moving him with passion to deliver the Israelites, kills the Egyptian, and then he realizes that he will be recognized by Pharaoh and killed, and so he flees to meet them. When he flees, he stays there for 40 good years, and then he sees the burning bush. Now, why did God take 80 good years in the life of Moses? Because of two things. He needed to teach him leadership in the best, the superpower of the time, Egypt. In the palace, the sons of kings would learn how to read and write, they would learn military and the like. But this was a failure. So God had taken Moses in the palace dramatically to teach him for the purpose that he was going to use him later in life. Then he takes him to Midian, and Midian is not just embedded in any family, but the family of a priest. And this priest helps him now for the third priesthood, and later on, Moses mentors his brother Aaron together with the other priests on how priesthood is supposed to be in the kingdom of God. What else was the theme? We are saying that God can move you to a particular passion in life slowly by slowly. I would want to ask you to go and reflect on your life. What has God been doing from the day that you were born, from your family, the life experiences you have had, the spiritual experiences that you have had? What else was it feel? Lastly, not lastly, but one, affirmation by the Holy Spirit through the church. In the book of Acts chapter 13, God calls Paul and Barnabas. As these brethren prayed and fasted, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit spoke and said, "Set aside for me Paul and Barnabas," and he had a special task for them. Lastly, today, by the grace of God, men who have experienced in ministry have been able to come up with what we call spiritual gift discovery tools. It's the one I have, one of them that I have here. Now, I will give these to the leaders, a soft copy as well. They will share with you. So this is a list of 85 statements that try to examine your life. For example, one of them says, "I enjoy starting a church or ministry in a foreign country or culture." Another one says, "I encourage people who are struggling in their faith through speaking, writing, artwork, singing, or prayer," and the like. As you fill these questions honestly, on a rate of 0 to 4, at the end, there is a scale that helps you to know this number of scores align with this area of spiritual gifting. What else was it feel? Are we together? Now, in discipleship, we actually do this. We did it with Akina Dennis Gedeji last year. See you? Praise the Lord. We did it with the guys that were, I think, the 4 years who left. So I want to invite you as well. As you come to discipleship, this is one of the topics that we handle and that we will be doing. We'll help you more on this. The last thing I want to say, as I conclude, is that the ministry offices are now backed up by the spiritual gift. Praise the Lord. The ministry offices and roles that we started with, now, when God calls you to be an apostle, he affirms that also by giving you some specific spiritual gifts to enable you be able to do the ministry of apostleship. Praise the Lord. and the same for teachers and the like. I want us to pray as we go through. Lord, we thank you because of your goodness. Thank you because you call men and women.